In this lecture, we'll learn about what our galaxy looks like and how stars orbit in our galaxy. If you've been able to get away from city lights, then perhaps you've seen the Milky Way arching overhead. Since we are embedded within the galaxy, it was no easy task to figure out its structure. It's like trying to describe the appearance of an unfamiliar house from inside a bedroom closet. Today, we'll talk about the techniques used by astronomers to understand our Milky Way galaxy. First, let's talk about what we do know. The Milky Way is a spiral galaxy with well over 200 billion stars. It's a relatively large galaxy and is just one of billions of galaxies in our observable universe. The Milky Way is called a spiral galaxy because of its lovely spiral arms. We've never been able to get outside of our galaxy to take an overhead image. It's simply too enormous. But if we could, it would look something like this figure. The spiral arms are part of a fairly flat disk of stars surrounding a bright central bulge. The entire disk is surrounded by a dimmer, rounder halo. The entire galaxy is about 100,000 light years in diameter, and the disk is about 1,000 light years thick. Our sun is located in the disk about 28,000 light years from the galactic center. It took us humans a long time to learn even these simple facts about the Milky Way's size and shape. It didn't help that the interstellar medium obscures our view of the galaxy, at least in visible light. Early astronomers like the Herschels tried to map the Milky Way by doing star counts, but because interstellar gas and dust blocks the light of so many stars, astronomers got the maps wrong. They were fooled into thinking that our sun was near the galaxy's center. It wasn't until the 1920s that an astronomer named Harlow Shapley used observations of globular clusters to show that the sun is not at the center of the Milky Way. So now that we know a little bit about what the Milky Way looks like, we can talk about how the stars move in the galaxy. We'll divide the stars up into three general populations: halo, disk, and bulge. Let's start with the disk stars. If you could stand outside the Milky Way and watch it for a few billion years, the disk would resemble a huge merry-go-round. The individual stars circle around the disk, but they bob up and down as they do, like merry-go-round horses. As a star orbits, if it overshoots and moves above or below the disk, the mass of the galaxy will pull it back. This is what gives the stars their up and down motions. The stars near us take about 200 million years to make one orbit around the galaxy, and one up and down bob takes a few tens of millions of years. The orbits of halo stars are much more elliptical, and the orientations are relatively random. The halo stars can go thousands of light years above and below the disk. The orbits of bulge stars are also more elliptical, with relatively random orientations. The differences in the orbits of the disk, bulge, and halo stars offer us clues to how our galaxy formed. We'll talk more about this in just a bit. The Sun orbits the center of the Milky Way at 220 kilometers per second. It takes about 230 million years to make one orbit. When our Sun was last in this part of the galaxy, dinosaurs were just emerging on Earth. The orbital motion of the Sun and stars gives us a way to determine the mass of the galaxy. We can use Newton's version of Kepler's third law to determine the mass of everything in our galaxy within the Sun's orbit. We find that there is 100 billion suns worth of mass within our orbit. Studying orbital motions of stars in our galaxy has revealed a mystery. Photographs of galaxies show that most of their mass is concentrated near their centers. According to Kepler's laws, this would mean that the stars closest to the center should be moving faster than the stars farther out. But this is not what we see. The orbital speeds remain about the same out to great distances from the galactic center. This tells us that most of the galaxy's mass must reside far from the center and is distributed throughout the halo. Because we see few stars and virtually no gas or dust in the halo, we conclude that most of the galaxy's mass must not give off any light that we can detect. We therefore refer to it as dark matter. We'll talk all about dark matter very soon. That's all for now. We'll get into more details about our galaxy next time.